IVM.
Hey everybody, welcome to another amazing week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Paytm Money, for supporting the network. Guys, you should definitely check out some of the content that we're doing recently, which is somewhat COVID-related. Pavan's been doing an awesome job on the Pragati Podcast. All Think Policy has also got a tremendous number of really, really great episodes about what's going on and the impact. We talk about this stuff on Cyrus Says, especially in the Cock and Bull episodes. On Advertising is Dead, Varun's had a couple of episodes where he's spoken about the impact of this, as is Karthik on the Filter Coffee Podcast. And I mean, like, you know, across the network, definitely do check it out. I'm sure you'll enjoy yourself. And with that, let's get you to your show.
Hello, listeners, and hello, Ayushi. Welcome to Agla Station Adulthood.
Hi, guys. Welcome aboard. We're on towards our next station while still on this lockdown train.
Yeah.
It's not been an easy couple of days. I think we've both been through some stuff, personally, professionally, right?
Yeah.
But this podcast does help us maintain some semblance of normalcy and a little bit of connection and sanity. So we're excited to be here to do it and put all the other stuff on pause for a second.
Yes, you know what? I like that and I'm in for that. We can't always just be like, you got to put your brain on pause also and just be like, I'm a record now, peacefully.
Yes, okay. And it kind of goes back to some of the things that I've said earlier in the podcast. I think as, you know, when you're talking to people who, when I used to tell you that, you know, it's too much wallowing, it's too much sadness, it's too much of these extreme emotions, just let's put it on hold and come back to like that center ground. And then,
yeah.
Because I think that's how I handle extreme emotions. It might not be healthy, but that's what we're going to do right now.
I like that. Okay, yeah. So for context, I have just not had a great morning. I'm just feeling a bit under the weather. It's not COVID.
Yes, but, I love that we have to keep specifying that it's not anything pandemic related.
Yeah, it's like a regular, you know, like indigestion, gas kind of who knows what situation.
It's a poo so problem.
I was feeling upset and then Ayushi said we have to record and I was like, you know what, fine. I can be sitting here and feeling sad and be like, oh, I don't want to record right now. I just want to keep being sad. Or I could be like, okay, let's record. Maybe I will feel better. And I already feel better 2 minutes in.
I agree. I was coming from a place of, there was a lot on my work plate today. A lot of shouty, fighty, problem, like fire extinguishing, which did not get extinguished. Not a real fire, just a hypothetical brain fire.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's why I was kind of keen to record just so I could have a reason to take a break from it.
Lols.
Being very cheeky. Anyway, let's quickly introduce today's topic. Today's station is...
Drum roll!
Say it.
You say it.
No, you say it. I said the drum roll.
Oh my God. We're going to talk about likability, the need to be liked. Why do we like people? What's going on? Like what? We're millennials. So like, we're just going to talk about like stuff like that.
Research suggests that likable people are very likable.
That's like saying the summer is very hot.
No, but you know, when again, this should be quite evident to you guys now. She just says random words and then I go research them. You said likability and I was like, okay, fine, let me do some research. And this was very easy to research for, but also difficult. I'll put it this way. There's just a lot of material on likability.
Mm.
And because there are so many kinds of ways of mapping personality and gauging your personality traits and which like block you come under, what letter you are, all these funky things, right?
Mm-hmm.
And likability is something that a lot of psychologists and schools of psychology have researched because of its relation to, say, professional success, romantic success, political success, etc., etc., you know?
Mm.
But by and large, like I said, likable people are very likable. That seems to be the conclusion of a lot of these. I read like 4 different studies. And then after the third one, to be honest, I was like, I can just read the introduction of this and figure it out. Like, I understand what this is going to go into. But I think what would be interesting to talk about is why we came upon the topic of likability.
Ah, do tell.
Which is why we were talking about hypocritical people.
Yes, hypocrisy and popularity. And
exactly. Why people act the way they do, because at the end of the day, you just want everyone to like you. And that's where this kind of came from. So we can do a little bit of I can give a little bit of background on some of the literature and research out there.
Absolutely.
But I think we should also talk about what likability means to us, like how we've interpreted it through from like teenage to now. And also then I'd like to talk about the root seed of this conversation, which was hypocrisy, the internet, and how it's just a popularity contest. If that's...
Love it. What a great signposting.
Yes, accidental signposting.
Yes, amazing.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So there's a couple of things that... So say the University of Massachusetts did a study on likability where they... and this is for a professional context. And what they found is managers would listen to an auditor, even if they didn't agree with the auditor on principle, as long as they found the auditor likable. And they obviously did a series of tests and like control environments and control room kind of, you know, situations where you're like, oh, would you still pick this? Would you still pick that? And it just came down to the personality and the likability index of the auditor. Then Talent Smart, which is a huge organization that does a lot of like personality and IQ and EQ tests, like globally, they did a study across, and their pool of people was 1 million people. Like they actually polled, the study was very large. And what they found out is likable people outperform non-likable people by a very, very considerable margin. Like, it's definitely obvious that the person has outperformed because they are more likable.
That, I mean, is like, I don't know what to say because that's so true.
Exactly. And then even the Australia Journal of Psychology says, you are more likely to retain your job if you are likable. And they did this across many multinational corporations and like HR studies and surveys across like Sydney, Melbourne, Brisbane, like all their big metropolitan cities in the country. So what you're kind of hearing from this is pretty obvious. So don't like stop listening because it sounds like we're just stating very normal, obvious things, is that the more likable a person, the more likely they are apparently to succeed in a workplace, in a romantic atmosphere. Now it comes into why are certain people more likable than others? And then our favorite thing to deconstruct, how gender plays a role in this.
Yes, because it does.
Yes. Big time. Economic Journal did a massive study on gender and likability, and what they found through various permutation combinations of relationship, and they use like money and sort of contributing to a cause based on relationships between men and women and how people judge that. And essentially what the conclusion was that likability is an actual asset for women, but likability is only a factor for men in male and female pairs. So what it basically means is that women, if they are likable, will do much
better.
It's better
for them,
yes. Whereas if a man is likable or not, it doesn't really truly matter unless he is being gauged by another woman.
Yeah, correct. That's why girls have been made to like, okay, we talk about
it. Exactly. So now that I've put all this on you, what have you sort of picked out from this?
Likeability for me has just basically, I think, it's changed in its definition. Like in school and stuff, of course, it was the need to have friends and the need to be liked so that you don't feel alone or left out and all of that. And I think somewhere that ends up creeping into your adult life also in small, small ways. But
no, you're absolutely right. Because I think when you're younger, being likable kind of almost, it becomes a foremost reason that you even do things or like participate in certain activities perhaps.
And even behaviors which you end up like exhibiting at home or with your parents. Like if your parents like you, or they don't like you for a moment, but you are like, you always want their approval and you want to be liked by your immediate family members also. So I think for me, that was also a big deal. Like, I wanted my parents to like me first. And I was like, I want everyone to like me.
But I think that's really interesting that you first wanted your parents to like you. Like, I don't think that was the first or the guiding principle for me to be likable. I was pretty much more, like, for me when I was younger, likability was more about popularity / coolness. You know what I mean?
Right, right. For me, it was more like doing the right thing and getting, like, just, you know, like being a good child, I suppose. And I think already I felt, and again, I'm sorry to bring this into it, but because I was a fat kid and my parents used to tell me, like, you need to lose weight, blah, blah, blah. I used to start thinking as a child that they resent me because I'm fat. So then I was like being extra good in all other spheres of life, so that I was like me. I know you love me, but maybe you can like me also.
So, you know, interestingly enough, when people are polled, but the statement, I like you, actually holds more value than the statement, I love you.
Absolutely, because liking is tough. Love is easy.
Exactly.
You can love someone but not like them all the time.
Yes, and love, when you say that you love someone, the assumption is that you love them despite their flaws. Liking someone is kind of like, oh, I like you because you don't have XYZ flaws. You have all these great points in you. You know, that's sort of the difference between loving and like. And it's amazing that even as adults, more often than not, we crave someone liking us instead of loving us.
Oh my God, yeah. You should give me a crush any day. I want to find out who has a crush on me and likes me a little bit.
And it's quite interesting how this whole concept of like and the word like has morphed into something so much more than just a popularity contest like when we were children.
Yeah.
When you just wanted to be liked by your peers because, like you said, it was about acceptance and being a part of something and feeling not excluded, essentially.
Mm.
Whereas now, liking is like, wow, we need to stop saying the word. But it's become a measure of success even, you know?
Because also, can I just, because of, the internet and, share and subscribe. Yes. I thumbs up everything. I'm like, ee.
But that's the whole point, right? Is that it's become a commodity in itself.
Yes, yes, yes.
It's become tradable. It's become, you've monetized it. And now what we've done is, I mean, we've always had this in terms of popularity contest was, it could be monetized because perhaps the most popular person had a higher chance of success before, you'd see a direct correlation there. Mm-hmm. But now what you've done is you've twisted this on its head by saying that you don't have to be generic and a cookie cutter to be popular and to get the likes. But if you get the likes, you'll still be worth putting a value on it. If you know what I'm trying to say is that, let me re-explain this. When you were younger, what being popular looked like a very singular thing.
Mm.
Now, being popular can be 10 different things. Like you can be kind of creepy, that's still popular. And you can be like a cookie cutter, California Barbie, and that's still popular. And then you can be like a very ethnically proud person of color, and that's popular. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And all of these things now can command likes, and that like can be turned into either power or money or success or, you know, whatever these things are. And that's why today, maybe that's why there's so many studies and research on likability, because our sort of social culture seems to be really branded on it now.
Absolutely.
This is how it works now. I don't know. It's a bit sad, isn't it?
I don't know. Yeah. I mean, I don't have anything to add to this because it's absolutely true. Everything that you've said, the word like itself has become very, you use it all the time. Firstly, you hear it all the time. And I feel somewhere it has changed in meaning because when you wanted to be popular younger on in life or within your immediate surroundings, like, for example, the building auntie who bakes fab cakes and distributes them every Christmas, she's popular. But she's popular for a different reason and she's well-liked. So I think that type of being liked or that quality of likability, I still, I feel I'm still chasing that. And because I very quickly came and went from this social media game, like, I was very obsessed with it being like, oh, I'm saying like so much, Ayushi, I'm going to cry, I'm going
to
kill myself.
No, I think it's only very obvious to us today because of the topic and how much we're saying. Because it slowly loses meaning, right, when you keep saying it again and again.
Right. So where was I? I just want to be well-liked. And the social media game became a bit annoying because...
Because you confuse those two, no? Sometimes, like, it's very natural to confuse those two. Like, oh, if I'm getting likes on social media, that means I must be a well-liked person. But I'm saying that there
is a difference. Which is totally not true.
Yes, yeah. I think there is a difference between it. And I think as adults or baby adults who are navigating this space while living life with social media and its kind of drawbacks, is to remember to make that differentiation, is in the sense that who you are as a person is different from the likes that you garner on a post or in a on an article or on a thread or whatever it is, you know, that you have to do these days.
Yeah. And I think instead of like focusing on wanting to be universally liked by the interweb or even for strangers, that I think takes away focus from one's own journey towards their own truth or whatever is their maximum potential for their life. Because your focus shifts outwards.
Absolutely. Right? And I think what happens is you start molding parts of yourself to seem more likable.
To suit society.
And in that you lose parts of yourself or your originality or your own thought process and whatever it is. But then, so there's the other side of it. A lot of people... What if, like, the pursuit of being likable has made people more woke? You know how I love to talk about woke people.
Lol.
LOL. But hear me out. This is something that I'm actually thinking of right now as we're talking.
This is it.
Okay?
I love it.
This is just, I'm rolling with it. Is that what if in the search or in the pursuit of being cool and being likable and being woke, you started accepting things that maybe you wouldn't have accepted on a normal basis. Like a very, very simple thing, like homosexuality, right? Not everyone was okay with it. Not everyone accepted it. Not everyone was not everyone liked it, to be very basic, right?
Yeah.
But then you started seeing cool and popular people accepting it. You saw the West in terms of, say, Hollywood or film and media kind of... it entered more of the mainstream, more representation. You understood more about rights, about legal, like, you know, the legalese behind it. And then you had really important people and figures attached to these movements. So what happened is you liked Tom Hanks, and Tom Hanks is for pride. So you're like, hey, I like him, and if he's doing
he can get behind that, I can get behind that.
Exactly. Yeah. So perhaps in the pursuit of being likable, you yourself start changing your mindset about things like, you know, racial profiling, about gay rights, about the queer identity, all these different things that maybe we wouldn't have accepted, but then because cool people accepted it and it was the cool
thing. And you
thing
know
to
somewhere
do.
That it's the right thing to do also, I guess.
Yeah, but I'm saying there might be people who didn't even think it's the right thing to do, but have just gotten swept up in it, even when it's like feminism, right? Today, men love to say that they're feminists. But I don't know whether they really, they are feminists or not, or whether they just think that that's a likable thing to be.
Yeah.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
Legit.
And I think that A, this sort of concept that I'm trying to explain is A, it's had great results because you've seen a huge sort of surge in the amount of people fighting for things that you and I know are right. We know that this is the right way to go forward. So I'm really happy that even if it was just a pursuit of popularity that you jumped on this bandwagon, great. This bandwagon can need all the help it gets.
Yeah.
Then you have to deconstruct things about, I think like feminism is a great tool, is that people say they're feminists because that's the likable thing. Like a man who says, oh, I'm a feminist, I'm against the patriarchy. You're like, I like that slice. But is he though? Is that person only saying it so they can be more accepted, so they can be more popular, so they can be more successful amongst their peer group? Or is that something that they genuinely believe? And I think that that's kind of a trap that we all fall into very often. Like, do you actually like Drake? Do you actually like Cardi B?
Yeah.
Or do you like it because people you like it?
Yeah.
And I think this is all the mystique around likability, right? The people who are likable are trendsetters, and they get to define the zeitgeist. They get to define what we like now. And I think that's a very, I don't know, maybe we can take a break here while I'm only rambling on and on. I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. I mean, I was like, let's go into a break and come back, because I think you've touched upon some really interesting things.
Yeah.
Friends, see you on the other side of Agra Station Adulthood, episode 37. Keep listening.
Do you wish you were smarter? Well, so do we. But the next best thing?
We could make you sound smarter.
And to help you with this endeavor, we are Simplified, a podcast that attempts to break down the complex world around you with a little knowledge, a lot of poor jokes, and a ton of random trivia.
Episodes out every Monday
on the IVM Podcast app or wherever you get your podcasts.
See ya!
Welcome back.
Hello, Tad.
Hope you enjoyed.
Okay, likeability. So
again, we've come back to this.
Because I was talking and I was rambling away, I think it's important for you to talk about what likability means to you now as a 27, 28-year-old.
I think what has actually gone down and happened is that slowly through these years of like professional world life and becoming a baby adult, I have discovered that utmost important thing is for myself to like myself.
Absolutely correct answer. Tera, you go to Harvard now. Go.
Because actually, no, my mom has been teaching this to us since we were little. Like, nobody can help you if you don't help yourself. So in the same way, I'm like, nobody can like you if you don't like yourself.
I love
yourself.
That we featured mummy logic once. Yeah, every show.
Man, why not? So that's where I'm at, I guess. But of course, I still struggle because I do want everybody to like me. I say it doesn't matter, but Ayushi, I do want more followers and likes and engagement. And I want real fans. Like, I want that shit to increase and I want more people to like me because, hello, it's an occupational hazard also for me. Like, I don't have to be liked, but I would. It's better for someone in my profession to be well-liked. And I full well know that, knowing that I'm not the most easy to like person either. And that brings me to the, are we projecting an image of ourselves, or are we always being our authentic selves? And I always veer towards being my real self. But I've been in the industry or whatever this entertainment world is for long enough to understand that sabke khane ke daant kuch aur hai and chabane ke daant kuch aur.
What a
It's about hathis, you know, because they can't chew with their tusks. They chew inside. Na hathi ke daat khane ke kuch aur, chabane ke kuch aur.
Oh my good lord, I did not know. See, elephants, Dash, I've been telling you since.
Elephants
so
are the best,
lord.
Guys. I just want to also just throw a soft plug of this elephant documentary I watched called Elephant. It's a Disney documentary and they've named the baby elephant Jomo, Ayushi. I couldn't handle it.
I can't. You know, the thing is with me, when I start watching these things, I have to pause it so many times because I have so many feelings that come out. Like, I don't have feelings during, you know, like my mom, we were watching Razi that day and she just got so stressed out by the entire scary factor that she walked out. She was like, no, she's going to die. I'm leaving. So she just left. I was not stressed out by that situation. But when I watch a documentary on whales, I have to keep pausing it because I'm like, they're not going to make it. Something is going to happen. And it's going to be wrong. Yes, exactly. But I will watch this documentary. Natasha told me about
it
as well.
Good. It's a beautiful one. Everyone watch it. It's called Elephant. And then...
I like it.
It's to the point, you know, like how our show should have been called Podcast. Best Podcast. That's it. Like, why did we write here? Because Glass Station Adulthood.
Best Podcast.
So...
Okay, so getting back to the point of our Best Podcast.
Yeah, we also like, see, for example, the podcast has also like launched a few months, whatever, many months ago. And before it launched, I was also like, dude, people have to like our podcast. You feel that kind of pressure, ki, like, what if people don't like it? Because if you don't like something that I have created by extension, I will feel attacked if you don't like me. Like, for example, if I make some sabzi or dal also, and my partner's like, it's okay. I take it personally.
Personal attack, of course.
You don't like the food because you don't like me, but that's not true.
But you've had to walk me down from this ledge many times when it came to the show. Like, when it came to like being remember in the middle when you said they're becoming very research heavy, they're becoming very serious topics, they're becoming a little not as like light as fun as and as fun as we thought it would be. And I was so obsessed with the entire idea of having the listeners think of, say, of us, but also me as a smart person, as an intelligent person, because to me that was likability, right? That if they think that I'm intelligent, they're going to either respect or like me for it. And I wanted that. And I had to keep deconstructing, and you explained it to me so many times, you and I guess even Kavita, but maybe more you because I heard it better from you, which was that people like the show, or at least we hope they like the show, is because we are a version of ourselves here. And if a version of ourselves isn't informed and isn't intelligent about a certain topic, that's okay. That's what they will like about it, is that we don't know everything about everything. And yet we're here discovering and exploring and going through that adulthood journey. And you kind of brought me back to the premise of our show, because I was getting really caught up in it being like, how to be more likable, you know?
Yeah.
And it's weird because for me, that likable aspect went into that intelligence aspect of it and not into humor, which I would normally go to. But as you know, I have that issue of like rejection and intelligence, and I have those internal issues that kept coming out. And it's interesting because that has maybe colored a lot of, say, my opinions in the past and the way that I interacted with social media, being like, oh, this is a likable political view to have. This is the likable stand to take, you know, this is the likable post. This is, but I think over the last year and a half, something that I've truly realized and I love, and I think I should thank you for it as well. I've really just become like, no, this is funny to me. This is funny to me.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm going to like. I like it because it's funny. It's dumb.
Because even like earlier on, like when you're a teenager, you kind of listen to music that everyone else is listening to because you think it's cool and you want to be cool and well-liked. But literally, I think, Aishi, this is what people even write about, no? Like, people in their 40s and all, they're like, by the time you reach 40, guys, you stop giving any f**ks about what anyone thinks of you.
But I think that this is a huge marker of adulthood, right? Is being secure. Because I think likability is very connected to security and sense of self.
Yes, yes.
If you are even 60% secure of who you are and sure of who you are, I think you automatically become likable because you're confident in yourself. And we all know that confidence is a huge number on the attractiveness scale. You know, like, she's like very confident. She's very confident. I like that. So I think if there's any takeaway from this, is it's not a short answer. Hey, just be sure about yourself. Is that maybe take the time to get to know who you actually are.
Yeah, and I think it's important, and I've been assessing this for myself also. Is it a need to be liked? Like, I don't need it. Like, it's okay. But do I want to be liked? Yes. But is one's happiness going to depend on those external factors? That's the question, like, I have asked myself again and again. Can I find my happiness from within, without the external stimuli of affection or liking or friendship or engagement and positive reinforcement of any kind?
It's a valid question. It's just a huge question.
Yeah.
No?
Like, also, and I'm going to fucking just be honest here, Aishi, because like my cards are on the table today. But even, for example, like if I have to go do an Instagram live, in my brain, there's like a small part which is like, you have to be smiley, you have to be upbeat, you have to be energetic.
Right.
And I'm just like, yuck, no, I don't, not always. Go away. That's really not how I feel right now. So I don't want to be pushing that just so that more people can like me. Because whatever you, even if you do stumble upon me in one of those great moments where I'm like, ha ha, yay, I'm so happy, and like me, everybody. That's not how anyone always is. It's exhausting to be a people pleaser and like keep wanting to make people like you. It can be so exhausting.
Of course, but then these are all those traps of social media that we've talked about, right? And not just social media, but like this outward projection in general, is that how much of your, I think we talked about it when we did like authenticity or something. We did an episode that was something like that, right? Didn't we? Earlier?
We didn't have an episode on authenticity. We have an episode on self-confidence. Maybe it
was correct. So I think, I think we discussed in that one, which was similar to this whole thing of if you are confident, then you won't really mind how you are being perceived. But if you're not 100% sure of yourself, then you will go to the default, which is what's a general form of being seen, what is accepted, which is super upbeat, super happy, always smiling. So I also think these kind of things come from, like, if that day you're not secure about yourself, you're not secure about your thoughts and emotions, wherever they are, then you're not going to be able to portray anything other than really just manic crazy, which will show what you're really feeling. Or then the safety option, which is plaster a smile on your face and just go about your day.
Yeah, which is all exhausting. All of it is exhausting. But I think a huge part of adulthood is also learning to do that some days. Like, especially
yeah,
at work.
Yes. Thank you so much. How you have changed.
I mean, Aishi, I am no longer the pure little button I once was.
Okay.
Jaded by this zalim dunya. Zulmi. Where was I?
Beta,
I lost
back.
My thought. I went into some dramatic Hindi dialogues about this world.
Beta Badal, come
yes.
back.
So, as a baby adult who does want to make it in life,
yes.
sadly, and I'm upset that this is the case. It is unfortunate, but yeah, we do have to work on being likable. And some days the only option is to smile and just be like, yeah, okay.
Because I also think it's it also becomes about, like, you know, task management, I think. Like, what is it that you need to get accomplished? Mm. And what is standing between yourself and getting that task accomplished? Sometimes, like, when it comes at work, I know that I want to just steamroller over everyone's opinion. I'm like, no, this is absolutely bullshit. This is the only way we should do it. But if I don't tailor my personality to be a bit more malleable, a bit more likable, a bit more acceptable, then 6 different personalities are not going to agree with me directly.
Of course.
Right? So then, in that situation, no matter how much my brain is saying that this entire meeting is a waste of time, sometimes I do have to do the thing of creating the illusion of, like, no, we're all valid, valid thoughts. Let's hear it out.
Yeah, good. Because then you don't want to be overconfident in your own thoughts. Because you never know. Maybe people might surprise you.
No.
I should be like, nah.
Today's not the day. But what I'm saying is sometimes you have to play that game. And unfortunately, likability is a huge asset in that game.
Yeah.
Which is, it goes back to that research, right? That women use it as an asset. But I think in general, likability is an asset because furthermore, in terms of the women thing, to be even taken seriously as a woman, if they don't like you, you're screwed. Whether you know your stuff or you don't. They just don't
so
like
I'm
you.
I'm just going to be honest up front with all of you. Already, men... and the world at large has decided that women have to be a certain way. Women who
yes.
fit that mold of what society has decided is a good, well-liked, likable woman, then all is well. But now bear in mind, all of us are not in that zone now.
And we're not in that zone all
exactly.
the time. You know what I mean? Like, you have the different facets of everyone's personality.
Exactly. So... it's unfair, but...
no, it is. And unfortunately, likability plays a huge part in women's success.
Oh my
story.
God, yeah. Like, literally. And that shit sucks.
Because there are people who you might think don't have the right caliber or true talent or actual any sort of substance to their work. But they're very likable
yeah.
people. So they've gotten very far in their journey. And I know for a fact that I've looked at women and men as well, but peers... Not like friends, but like peers in terms of like workplace peers. And been like, well, she's an idiot, but she's so likable that people just go along with what she's saying.
Yeah.
There are guys at work who actually are just so blithely unaware of anything other than their own opinions and thoughts and everything. But the dude is so likable and charming and affable. And he can speak in 3 different languages. And I'm sorry, but I can't gab in Marathi with people. So the whole likable factor, the approachability factor changes and that person is automatically going to have an easier time convincing people.
Exactly. So everything becomes easier for that person if they are well-liked.
Exactly. And so I think as a gender and even as a cohort, we as women have spent so much time being likable that we've kind of lost so much of who we might have actually been.
Yeah, maybe.
Because we've always put the docile thing first. We've always put the calmer side of ourselves first. We've always said that, you know, outside, I need to still be an attractive, composed, in control person who is still like flirty and sweet and approachable,
yeah, but not too wishy-washy.
And it's this huge, like, if you see what you need to be likable, whether it's from movies or TV shows or like Instagram or Twitter, whatever it is, it's like, either you have to be that generic thing that you see on Instagram of, oh my gosh, she's so pretty and sweet and likable. Or then on Twitter, you're this other person, like a woman who only talks about like farts and shits and discharge and vagina. And she's like, I don't care if you like me, whatever. And then people like her because like, oh, she's so unabashedly herself. Like, but there has to be some sort of central part in this, like where we don't have to be two extremes of something. And that's the only way that you can be likable or popular. Like I feel confused about this a lot of the times, yeah, I'll be same. Honest.
It like trips me up also because I'm looking at the world and I'm like, what is it that so many people are talentless dumbos? Don't even get me started on the breed of actors that exist, and not even just actors, like at large, just like dumbos everywhere. I hope I don't get into any trouble for saying this.
What is there to say? I already know who I'm going to criticize.
So then it's like, aapne itni mehnat kar li hai ki aapki personality aapne samaj ke hisab se mold kar li. To aap isme kahan ho? Aap khud to kho gaye na.
And there is no aap anymore. There is no you. There is just a version of you that is what you are putting out because, and unfortunately, it goes back to what we said earlier. It's because likability is monetizable now. Like it has a monetary value. And for me, as you know, one of my five triggers, Rupi Kaur, just intensely dislike her. Now, I truly want to know this person in my eyes. Chalo, I won't speak for anyone else, even though I know you guys are out there and you all support me on this. I have a lot of DMs to prove this. I swear. I, as a person, from my eyes, as someone who is decently well-read, and consider and is educated. Okay? For all intents and purposes, I'm an educated person. Correct. Actually, I am an educated person. It's not intents and purposes. I am educated. I don't like her. I don't relate to her brand of poetry or literature.
Yeah.
I think it's pretty worthless and it's pandering at best. Yeah. Okay? But people love her.
Yeah.
Now, I want to understand what is the likability index about this person. So, I have read so many articles about her. I've read her book. I've done it. And here's my thing. I was like, okay, I'm going to do this because at least if I'm going to criticize her, I'm going to criticize her from a place of knowledge. I'm not going to just blindly criticize her. What she portrays, right, of her, the diagram of women that she draws through the poetry, through her writing, is that,
oh my gosh,
I am gentle, I am frail, I am this, but I am also strong, but I am mountain, I am ash, I am fire, but I am also fish, I am also water. And it's like, oh, okay, this is rubbish, because it's not really saying anything concrete. You're just saying all the vague, generic things that we have around conversation. But look, I can keep going on about this and I should probably stop myself. And I will, because this is rude. I agree. I fully agree this is rude. But this is a person who has made a career, I think, on likability. I think people like her and so they've accepted her poetry.
So I don't have such strong feelings about her poetry. I don't mind it. But I understand what you say. Because also,
you can't write a sentence and then just hit the space bar whenever you feel like starting a new line and call that poetry.
I am water, soft enough to offer life, tough enough to drown it away.
What is that?
How you love yourself is how you teach others to love you. Now that's legit. She has written.
But that's a normal thing. You said it, your mother told you. Your mom told you. Nobody will love you till you love yourself. Do you see her signing books?
But see, this is...
You can't just take idioms and turn them into other... Like, it's a poem now.
This is also some kind of luck and all, no? Aishi, like, the world is so big now and because of the internet...
Likeability.
Yeah, and there is an audience for everything as we have discussed time and again.
She is a very pretty, gentle woman of color, and I do not like criticizing her based on those facts. I'm criticizing her purely on the fact that I think
you don't enjoy her writing, which is totally fair.
I do not enjoy
totally
it.
Fair.
But this does bring us back to why we started this conversation. information.
What is it about this being liked? I'm tripping.
No, but I also think like this pursuit of likability has made people complete hypocrites.
Yes, because popularity over everything else.
Like we, just a loose example, and I think I'm going to say it. I'll be censored, don't worry. Is that it was a situation on Instagram where there is one Instagrammer who was very, very anti the thoughts and say political leanings of another Instagrammer, okay? And not personally that Instagrammer, but in general, they were against these
ideas. They are from opposite sides, I guess.
Right. And then to promote each other's work, they did a live together or a story together, or some interview together. And I was just looking at this, like the when they were promoting it and doing all of this stuff. I was like, so what happens to all, say, the anger and criticism and vile and vitriol that you were spewing against each other's ideologies, that you have decided to put that completely aside so that you can promote content or a product?
That's what.
And my thing was, I had respect for these individual people because of how much they stood to their guns.
Yeah.
Like, you know, respectfully, a lot of the stuff that both of them said was kind of like, but this is who we are. This is the people that we stand for. And I will fight for the right to defend these people always. Yeah. And I will never align myself with the opposite camp because you're nothing but a bunch of XYZs, right?
Yeah.
But when it came to, like, I don't know what money or whatever was exchanged and through the whole process, but it just made me question. Look, I don't know. Maybe you have to do things to, like, fulfill your roti, kapda, makan situation. And look, I do it too, man. Like, I preach environment, but I've worked for coal companies. Like, I get it. I'm a hypocrite.
I mean, we all are. It's like the Sarabhai versus Sarabhai song. Hypocrisy me jeete ye sare hai.
Exactly.
You can't say.
So then you have to accept that we are not.
Yeah.
So, but then do you not think that people who take these very, very strong stands should at some time have that self-reflection to be like, maybe I also not so strong.
Yeah. I think that's like everybody should be reflecting.
Because I fully accepted that today, even when you, something in our country, which happens very often is, I think political leanings influence a lot of whether you're likable or not.
Yeah.
It's huge. It's a huge thing in our country. It's a huge thing on social media. It's a huge thing on like your wokeness, your likability, your popularity. Yeah. It really depends on where on the political spectrum you stand. And I'm saying that that's a very interesting thing because when you look at people and you think that they stand for X, Y, Z, You must know. And listeners, like I request you to know this, is that people, and this is a very obvious thing, but you're not everything that you post. You know that, right? Like people are multifaceted. They can say that they're against something or they can say that they're for something. But at the end of the day, when it comes down to it and making a decision, you are governed by your needs and what is necessary for your livelihood and your lifestyle. Mm. And at the end of the day, not a lot of people are going to distinguish themselves for that. But they will portray what you want to see so that they are likable.
Yeah, I would definitely second that. You are being given a version. You are being fed something which is curated to the point of which now people are curating their personalities for the digital space. I would just say don't be influenced by influencers.
Yeah, like, I don't know. I think watching people during this last month, because I've spent too much time on my phone, is that suddenly you're seeing parts of a person and you're seeing parts of personalities and you're like, I don't know, is this real? Do you really live your life like this? Because I don't. Yeah. I don't. I think that there is hypocrisy in a lot of my actions, and I think we both truly, even what we were talking about earlier, I think we really fight daily to be good people.
I fight every hour, every minute.
But that's what I'm saying. I think being likable and making the right decisions or making the informed decision is a struggle. It's really, really hard.
And it's also a toss-up between like the moments in time where you have to choose being likable over living your truth. And I think that's the struggle of adulthood, where you're also trying to be a better person, but you also understand that this is a f*** all world. and not everyone is right and just and honest and real and true.
Yes. Ah, we found a moral. We found a moral.
I'm a moral science lecturer.
No, we found it. We found it. I guess this is what we were trying to say with this whole thing is that there you have to know that we're not all good or bad or likable or unlikable. It's not just one thing that can define you. I think what we should be pursuing is security of self as opposed to likability. Yeah. And I know that I struggle with it a lot. We've talked about how sometimes even an Instagram post has upset my whole mood. So this is not coming from a place of like, oh, we've done it, so you do it. Absolutely not. I think we're saying the opposite is that it's a work in progress.
Yeah.
And the shift from switching from likability to like self-confidence is something that is part of the adult journey.
Because the self-confidence will be inside you and it will stay with you for your whole life. This life...
Far longer than likability.
People liking you and getting affection and attention and adulation. Literally, you are hot one day, next day somebody else is going to come. And that's so sansar ka niyam. It just keeps happening that way.
Yeah, there are so many more rupees now. It's unbelievable.
I'm dying. You should stop now. Both of you.
Okay, sorry.
Respect to all. Everybody do their own.
Yeah, that is actually very true. My apologies. I am sorry. If you like anyone's poetry, art, and literature, that's your right. And don't listen to me. I'm a silly girl who is just sad that she didn't put her poems out first.
Oh, let my God, tell me about it. Like, even I've had so many of poems. I'm like, content creators, doing sketches. Bitches, I've been doing it since 2013. But now I'm like not interested because I'm like, everybody's doing it. What am I going to do? Make more noise in this already f-ing cacophonous jungle.
See, guys, we struggle.
Sorry, we're not perfect. And I just also sometimes inside.
Oh, we have some anger.
Daily battle.
We're not so like... But we hope you enjoyed this episode and please let us know your thoughts, feedback. Even if you didn't like it, let us know. We'll try to do better by ourselves.
We don't need likability. Oh, no, do we? Please like, share and subscribe.
By the way, I wanted to tell you something which was so sweet. Is that somebody DM'd me saying that they heard one of our episodes that was during quarantine. And they really enjoyed it and they listened to it while cleaning the house and everything. And then she said, and whenever I get stressed, I just remember what you guys said, which is to breathe. I take deep breaths and I feel calm. And I wrote back, I said, Tash will be so happy to hear that. So I wanted to give you that little gift. You help someone de-stress.
I'm crying now again.
Oh no. I think we should go.
Thank you for listening, everyone.
Okay, bye guys. It's been really fun.
Look, up in the internet. It's a meme. No, it's a cat video. No, it's the Geek Fruit Podcast.
That's right. We interrupt this riveting broadcast to tell you about our show, the Geek Fruit Podcast, where Tejas, Dinkar, and I, Jishnu, talk about everything in pop culture, including DC, Marvel, Star Wars, Netflix, and everything in between.
You know how your friends hate it when you ramble about some nerdy crap and you just want somebody to listen to you? Well, sorry, there's nothing we can do about that, but come listen to us ramble and it'll almost be like the real thing. Kind of.
Listen to new episodes of the Geek Fruit Podcast every Monday and the Geek Fruit Bulletin every Thursday on iTunes, Google Podcasts, the IVM app, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Happy listening, you nerds.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, a show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere, robo-advisors, startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money. Now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday and you can listen to my show on the IVM Podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have. Paisa Paisa is brought to you by Paytm Money.